Welcome back to the cryptography theory. Here we are learning for some of the pseudo-random functions. Of course, the application of those pseudo-random functions I find in cryptographic key generations. I usually make a comment that cryptographic algorithms are not hidden, these are open to all. Where actually the security lies in the key and the usage of the key. So to me, the key generation is very important aspect, and we need to have certain overview of the key generation. Whenever we talk about for the complexity of the cryptographic algorithms, and if the breaking of the algorithm in a point of the opponent itself, then we may categorize those algorithms, maybe some easy algorithms or maybe some hard algorithms. Of course, the finding of a key or a breaking of the algorithm, if you find out the answer in polynomial space, that is, it is the complexity class, then definitely you will require some exhaustive search is required. One of the example is brute force attack for the space concern. However, if the answer lies in the polynomial time, then we can directly calculate the answer, and these are the P problems or these are the easy problems. If the answer lies in the polynomial time, still having the high probability, that is, there is another class of the problems which we call as the bounded error probabilistic polynomial time, and these classes are some of the categories of the decision problems. So somehow we need to move from these easy solutions to the hard solutions, and any algorithmic attempt should be in such a way that we need to increase the crypt complexity of the algorithm. And that crypt complexity can be increased by many of the methods. Here I would like to concentrate for the usage of the key and how the key can be designed. So in that way, we need to study some of the aspects where the probability is one of the major concern. Let me give you one of the idea. Say I have some key space where the key is designed over 0, 1, and let 8 bits are used for the key design itself. So if the key size is 8 bit, then definitely the key space is 0, 1 raised to 8. That means I may say that the key space is 256. So all we are agreeing for this one. Now suppose I have a set which is the proper subset of the particular key space. That means some of the keys are allowed for the usage. Let those keys are given with the set A itself. Then probability of the guessing of the key from set A, I can just find it out that it is the cumulative, or it's a total sum of, that is, the probability of the individual instance within the key set. So instance X may be the part of your allowed key set where you can have some summation of this one, and obviously the summation will equal to 1 itself. That is the normal mathematics what we can say. So in that case, suppose I have a set here where I need to go for certain keys which are represented in terms of the instances X, such that let the LSB, least significant bit of the key itself, that is two least significant bits are equal to 1. So, and obviously this is given within the allowed key space with you. So what is the probability that my key X is having the 2 LSB as 1, 1? Can we guess? So obviously we need to consider that this is uniform distribution of the elements over the given range for the elements 0 and 1. So what should be the probability of A? Can we guess? Can we have a thought process for this one? Yes, we can think in a way that suppose if 2 elements out of 8 bits are given. Why 8 bits are given? Okay, 8 bit size of your key is there. So out of 8, if 2 are known, already known, then 2 by 8 is the probability, the required probability. So we can call that this is the having the 2 by 8 or is equal to 1 by 4 as the probability for finding out the instance X. So in a similar way, if I have a clubbing of more than one condition, that if I have 2 LSB as 1-1 or 2 MSB as 1-1, I have given OR condition, but still the probability may have the summation of these two. So I can say that it's an individual probability of A1 instance, that is the 2 LSB, and the A2 instance, which is having the MSB, 2 MSBs are there. So it should be less than or somewhat equal to, rather 1 by 4 plus 1 by 4. 1 by 4 already we have calculated here. So that is equal to 1.5. So 1.5 is the probability if it is given. Then in that way we can have certain quantification of the, say, guessing of the particular probability, and depending on this particular guessing, now we need to have certain comment or certain discussions. So whatever are the algorithms we study under the computer science and the applications, so we have some simple recursive algorithms, we are having some backtracking algorithms, we are having divide and conquer algorithms. Every algorithm is having its own style, because whenever we learn any algorithm, we learn according to the major category. Some dynamic programming algorithms are there, greedy algorithm is there, because the approach go on changing, and with those approaches we need to study the algorithms. Some branch and bound algorithms are there, brute force algorithms are there, and randomized algorithms. Actually, my interest lie here with the randomized algorithm, where the algorithms need to be, say, some random usage of this one. So what exactly I expect with the randomized algorithm? I can say that the application of the randomized algorithm lie, or these will help to find out a solution to the problem, or more precisely, I would like to say that it will help you to improve a solution. That means it is always in the testing phase, or some random samples are used, then you need to have certain random testing for the checking the performance of the algorithm. So in that way we can have the applicability of the randomized algorithm. If any cryptographic algorithm is considered, definitely the algorithm is deterministic. So what is the meaning of the deterministic? That means whatever you apply, you will get the same and unique solution for every possible pass or the run of your algorithm. So however, passing the key to the particular deterministic algorithm, that passing of the key is randomized. So we are having the application of the randomized algorithm in utilizing the key itself. So if I have any key which I can find it out of those keys, that these are the possible keys, which is the key space, out of which you can have a selection, which is the random selection of any instance key K, and that is out of your capital K set. So this is the random selection, and that random selection is having very importance in the theory of your cryptography. So whenever we talk about the random numbers and usefulness, of course, the application lie in some of the area where if unpredictable processes are there, then definitely these can be defined or can be simulated for the perception. Some statistical practices are there, then definitely we can have some emulation of randomness. Some experimental analysis is there, definitely we can have some results, and those results can be shown. Some ubiquitous use of unpredictable numbers are there, and such applications lie in theory of cryptography. Some decision making ideas are there. These can be gone with some predictions with game theory itself. So accordingly, if random numbers are studied, then we may say that many uses of random numbers are there. If specifically considered in cryptography, then I may suggest few of those. Some are nonces in authentication process. So those nonce values are very important. For example, you may find out here that if initiator and responder both are working in a communication channel, there are certain, say, combinations of, say, responses are there. With those combinations, if any cryptography is there and which may get handled by a central authority or any public key authority is there, to have a cross check for the nonce values, the nonce value, you may find out that there is some request from the initiator to the responder. To that particular nonce value, there is some response, and to that response again you can find out one way or two way or even three way authentication. So that particular idea comes out with the nonce values, and these are the integer values which are totally random one, because for this random value there is again the reply with some another random value, and in together there is a response, and that response is considered as if it is the authentic response. So I can say that there are some nonce values which are involved in the authentication protocols. You may have certain session keys, because anyway if any of the key is used, we cannot keep the key valid for the entire lifetime of the algorithm, because some of the algorithms are crackable in some definite time period. For example, some polynomial time period, or polynomial space period, or maybe some non-polynomial solutions are there. For example, if we find out some DES algorithm, which is very well known and popular, but still with some time constraint, it is believed that DES is breakable within 22 hours itself. So we should not keep the existence of a key for the life itself. We need to have certain breakable life periods for those for which we can consider as the session, and the generation of the session keys or the duration of this one we may just create by the random number itself. Some of the public keys are to be generated, and those public keys are maybe the say applications of the random generations. You may find out in the RSA algorithm, or even some key exchanges with the Diffie-Hellman, the generators, or even ECC, that is elliptic curve cryptography, these will go for the finding out the random numbers. So in the some key streams are there in one time pad. So we have found that in one time pad it is providing highest security, where the size of the message is equal to the size of the key itself. So in all cases, the whatever we need to go for some critical applications, we need to go for some random numbers, and those random numbers should be statistically random. What exactly it means, I'll tell you. It should have certain uniform distribution. It should be independent from one number to other number. There is some unpredictability for the finding out or the guessing out the number. And whatever is the number given, you need to, there is a very hard expectation that you need to forecast or even find out the earlier values. So actually such capabilities are there by true random numbers, and if you use the true random numbers, obviously these will provide some of the requirements in our cryptographic functions. So whenever we go for the true random and the pseudo random concept, the true random concept is defined where some exhibition of some true randomness, and actually it is available in the nature itself. Maybe some ticks are there from the say exposed material, or the radioactive element is there. So there is no periodicity, there is no judgment in what way the particular ticks are there. But if we go for some pseudo random, it is defined as having the appearance of the randomness. It is not actually the random, but it is the appearance of the randomness, and exhibiting a specific repeated pattern for this one. So numbers calculated by computer, whatever we are using some of the functions, are having some deterministic process, and definitely these are calculated or found as if it is the these are the pseudo random numbers. Okay. Hence, overall, if the comparison is made for the two random number generators and pseudo random number generators, we may have certain characteristic against we can have a comparison, that if the pseudo random number generators are there and two random number generators are there, if the efficiency is considered, obviously we expect that it is from a nature, and it is not giving me the as expected number of clicks or ticks are there. So I can say that in efficiency wise these are poor, and the pseudo number generators, you may have the numerous functions out of those. So I can have here that is the efficiency is excellent. Considering the determinism, obviously as expected the pseudo random numbers generators are deterministic. So if we give some specific fashion for the running of the particular function, then it is behaving in the same way, where the two random generators are not having a specific pattern. So we may call upon that these are non-deterministic for the workability. Periodicity is considered, then definitely we can have a certain period, and the uniformity within the period can be maintained, where the two random generators are not periodic, and hence we find that the pseudo random number generators are useful in the cryptographic applications, and we are continuing with these pseudo random generators because it's very difficult to go for the two random numbers and the generators out of this one. So out of those pseudo random generators, whatever we are going for, if we find out that true random and source for this one, some generator is there, and if whatever is the number we expect, that is in a binary format, so we can find out some random bit stream with the true random number generators itself. But for your deterministic algorithm, which is considered as if it is the pseudo random generator, we need to have a certain initial seed value around which the numbers are generated, and we can have certain, say, application over this one. So we need to have certain input that can be considered as the seed value, and it can have certain, say, output back, or the recursive mechanism is there which gives you certain pseudo random stream is there. So that is about the pseudo random number generator. Or even certain function is used, then we can say that some seed value is there, and to which application we are using this pseudo random, we need to give some context specific boundaries or the range for this one with which the numbers are to be generated, and these are about to get utilized in the application itself. So whatever are these pseudo random number generators are there, we are having certain requirements. So obviously it should follow the randomness, that is the true randomness. It should have certain idea about this one, though not exactly. So it should maintain some uniformity. It should be scalable enough to my application size. It should be consistent enough. So these are the very common terms. So accordingly, those we need to have the perception of the requirements. What is the predictability of these? Though it's a pseudo random, there should be unpredictability for this one. Even forward and the backward predictability should not be there. Use some test for the predictability of this one. We may have certain statistical test. I'll cover up those tests, few of the tests, in the same session itself. It should maintain the full period. That means it should not be biased to some of the end of the particular, say, value range of the given particular function itself. Whatever is the seed value you are providing, definitely you need to maintain very high security for your seed value. And if that seed value is known, that means it is advisable that you need to just consider the security of this seed value, because the every output is dependent on the seed value itself. So that seed value should be very, very random, and you need to have more precautions for the generation of the secure random seed value itself. There is one function you can find out that some of the I values are there, that is the instances are there, and some of the XI instances are there, you may find out some large values are there. So even though some large values are there, we may apply certain function, and we can find out that even though some large integer values or even floating point values are there, just try to find out the, say, style of your number. We find that if my number is odd number, then it is giving me the output as the 1. If the number is even, it is giving me the output as the 0. So whatever are your numbers, maybe decimal number, maybe hexadecimal number, or even any other radix if you are using for the number calculation, then you are trying to convert this into the binary form, and those binary numbers you may consider as if this is the bit stream for your key pattern itself. And out of this key stream, now you can utilize some portion of that stream as if it is the key itself. So whenever I talk about the pseudo random function, I'll say that the pseudo random function is there, and I want to define this into the key space K, into the plain text input, that is the X, and the cipher space, that is the Y, is there. So if I try to just collaborate all these parameters together, and if I want to go for a function that is with certain key, with some operation over the plain text, if the cipher is written such that there exists some efficient algorithm to find out the combination of a specific key K out of the K and for a message X, which is the part of the capital X. So for a specific operation, for a single combination of the key and the plain text, if we need to apply a function, that function should be the efficient one. And accordingly, we need to find out certain combinations of those functions. And those combinations, I would like to say that it's a pseudo-random permutation of the function. So pseudo-random permutation defined over the key space K and the message space X is there. So I'm just discarding here the cipher Y. Then if any encryption algorithm is there from the key space K and the X, if it is giving me some value, because ultimately if it is for the combination of the encryption and decryption, it should return back to the 1-to-1, that is, it should again retrieve back with the plain text as it is. So we may read in that fashion. So we may say that some efficiency is there in terms of determinism of the algorithm to find out the specific instance for the encryption for a specific key K for the specific message X. That is, the function is there for a key. That function, I need to go for the one-to-one requirement, and we need to go for the existing of the inverse function, which is the one-to-one function, so that the decryption is possible for the same key K and the possible cipher for this one. So in that way, I can say that the pseudo-random permutation, what we found, as if it is the efficient one, it is the part of your pseudo-random function itself. So some or other way, pseudo-random permutation can be the part of function or can be used the term as if it is the interchangeable term. So in a way, I would like to go for one of the example. Suppose I have already studied about the DES algorithm or even AES algorithm. In AES algorithm, K and X, if we consider, because we are going for the one-to-one and the invertible, so I am just discarding here the cipher Y. So key space and the plain text, if it is returning back to the plain text space again, where key space and the plain text for the AES algorithm both are having the size of 128. So I would like to say that it is going for this much of the space for me for having the different alternatives. While for the DES algorithm, I can say that the plaintext is having the size of the 64 bits as the block. So X is having the particular space this much, where the key can be 56 bits. So I can say that key space will be 0 1 raised to 56. In the case of your 3 DES algorithm, again the amount of, that is the plaintext size, is remaining as if it is the same one, but the key is given for the 3 times. So I can say that it is going for the 3 times and the key space is going to be 168, which is the possible, say, multiples of your 0 1, wherever you are using any key for the usage. So functionally, any pseudo-random permutation is also the pseudo-random function. What I am saying, a pseudo-random permutation is a pseudo-random function where the inverse, that is the retrieving back cipher to the plaintext as it is, and it can be, say, one to one. So in that way we can have the application. So with this, I'll have one of the discussion. Suppose I have a function f where key space and the plaintext are considered. Let these are having some equal size as the 128, likewise your AES algorithm, or which is the requirement for your one-time pad, that is providing the higher security, you need to have the same size for your plaintext and the key as the same one. It should be secure if there is some function g, and we need to find out whether the security lie. So I defined here the function g over the instance k and x, which is the part of your key and part of your message. It is having equal to 0 if my plaintext is containing all zeros as the element. So maybe 0 raised to 128, 128 times. And if my plaintext is other than 0, it will go for some application of some function. So I would like to ask you a question, whether the function g is secure enough? Can I have a, say, answer for this, whether it is having the security, yes or no, or it is depending on the function f? We need to think upon for this one, because you may find that whatever is the function you are using, there is a clear cut, say, bifurcation of the function for the workability, because there is only a case that if my plaintext is having all zeros, that is taken as if it is a very separate, as a genuine case. So if we go for any function other than this one, my answer here goes with as the no, this is not a secure function, because it is easy to distinguish function g from the random function, where the attacker can separate out for the input x is equal to 0, all zeros are there in the plain text and other than this one, and an attack will be there on such a function for g, just discarding this particular instance and then go for the breaking of the f itself, because this is easily, say, recognizable. You can separate out this case, and that's why I would like to make a comment that this particular function g is not a secure. Let us try with some easy application. Suppose I have some pseudo random function out of some generator is there, and suppose I want to go for some key, and let it's a n bit key. So from n bit to n bit, if the function is there, that means from the source to the destination, if we are applying, that is from the input to the output for the generation of any key pattern for the which is based on the 0 1, and I want to work this as if it is secure for the pseudo random function, then what I can do, that I can just go for some function g which is applying the key k, which is n bit again, and as if it is working over the secure pseudo random generator, then I can say that the application of that particular function key is there, that if some plaintext 0 is there or 1 is there, that means I am just giving you some samples of this one, the 0th sample, first sample, second sample, tth sample or t minus 1 samples are there, and if these are used in a concatenation or some say independently, then definitely I can say that if the key property, if my key is following, that it is, if it is applicable in a parallel way for the different samples of your plain text, then that parallelizable is the major property where I can break down the given message into some say deep partitions itself, and independently those partitions will get operated enough. So even though if any say chance for having the expose of or the finding out a particular say key is there, it is slightly impractical because you are just changing down the input, that is the blocks which are under the application over the same key itself, and that's why we can maintain the security of the pseudo random function. That function can be applied over certain dot sample of your input data itself, and I think this is the one of the very important idea which was given in the counter mode of your application or some say compartments of your applications, when different blocks are used, which are used or which are getting applied in parallel to, which is the mode of your operation, even though it's a block mode of your operation. Maybe the CBC mode is there, maybe some say counter mode is there, or likewise you can apply your ready function in a secure way. So we can say that this is having a very good property and that can be utilized, because it's very hard to find out a very secure function which is applicable for all possible your input data. So you can just have here the parallel operation so that it is less guessable to the observer itself. So I was talking about these statistical tests. I can say that some suitable metrics should be there which will investigate the degree of randomness, because we understood that the randomness is the necessary criteria for the generation of the key, and we need to check that whether the randomness is fulfilled or not, and for this purpose we are having some test, and you can go for any of the tests. However, some of the tests which are suggested by NIST, these are including some of the parameters, maybe in terms of thresholds, or maybe some say fixed ranges are given, and if the range is exceeded by the element itself, or some probability values are there, if the probability checks are there, so accordingly there are some tests are there. You may just list it out, you may find it out with various resources. I'll give you a few of the tests just as if it is the hint. For example, if any frequency of your key or your data is there, too many zeros or too many ones are there, then definitely this is not advisable as if it is the good key for you. So it need to have certain good frequency or the containment of the elements zeros and one. Some cumulative sums are there, too many zeros or too many ones at the beginning or the end side, or some skewness is there for the distribution of your zeros and ones. Again, this is not advisable. What are the run you are finding, maybe the say size of your length, maybe small length, maybe large length, or any deviation what you are finding out for the distribution of the long runs, okay. So that deviation should not be too major, or even some rank is there, because these are the some of the say patterns. You may have such taste for some different calculations. For example, if any intrusion detection checks are there, wherever you are at the perimeter level for the security concerns, you are having such type of the parameters for the checking purpose. If you are having some spectral analysis, periodic features are there. If you are having some conversion from say magnetic domain, that is a special domain, to some transform domain or the frequency domain, you can find out certain spectrum for the bit stream, and it will allow you to check out whether this is giving you the desirable, advisable say pattern or not. Accordingly, you may find, suppose there are certain oscillations are there, so too many oscillations or the abrupt changes are there for the zeros and ones, again these are not advisable. So there are few tests I have just listed out here as the 15 tests are there. There are so many other tests are there. I may say that there is some say content of your key itself. We never thought upon about the content of the key itself. For example, some entropy of the key is there, approximate entropy. If you calculate non-uniform distribution of the some length of your words or the sizes there, small values or some irregularities there, then okay, what will be the particular consent? You need to just find it out. You can have certain cases for the situation. Maybe you may have some SHA algorithm or some other hash algorithms are there. In what way some randomness or the walk of the randomness is there. Accordingly, we may find it out. I'll give you a few tests here, some examples as if. Suppose I have again some 0, 1 as the key space with me, n bit key is there. And I have some algorithm A such that algorithm A with some instance X, X is taken as if it is the key itself, which may output either 0 or 1 value. If it is giving me some falsifiable value, 0 and 1, there is no confusion about any there. So I can say that it's a successful. So for any decision problem, if your decision is 0 or 1, it is considered as the successful decision problem. Otherwise, it is considered as if it is the undecidable problem. So if it is giving you some decidable solution, then definitely I'll call that this is the successful problem. For example, I'll say that if my output is 0, I'll have certain assumption that this is not random, and if my output is 1, I assume that it is having a random say generation of the elements. For example, if the algorithm A with some instance X is having output as the 1, when output as the 1, it's a random. That is, I can say that for the particular say check is there, number of zeros, successive zeros in the say particular instance X, and the number of ones are there. If the balance is checked with the negation of this one and taking the say absolute value of this one, then I can say that if the say difference of the number of zeros and ones, if it is less than the 10 multiplied by square root of the value of the particular stream, what bit pattern you are using, then I can say that it is random. I may have another criteria, that is, suppose I have double zeros in a particular bit patterns are there and number of double zeros are there. If these number of double zeros are say having the value, that is, if the length of my bit stream is n and n by 4 is one of the criteria I use as the one of the guess, and number of zeros, successive two zeros are there, and minus the n by 4 if the value is taken, and if it is having again the less than some predefined value, then I can say that it is random. So accordingly, suppose maximum number of zeros are there, and if it is less than the 10 multiplied by what is the size of your bit length n, and take the log of value of this one, and if it is less than this one, I can say that it is having the random generation of this one. Otherwise, it is not the random. So accordingly, I can define some criteria, and that criteria, if it is fulfilled by the instance X, then I can declare either it is random or it is not random. And accordingly, that particular test I may carry out for finding out the particular bit pattern. I would like to go for a very interesting case for you, which is just containing some entropy. So what exactly is the entropy of any of the bit pattern? So I would like to say that it is the amount of information, that is number of bits if you are considered. Suppose I have 4 bits with me, so 1000 and 1001. So I would like to say that 1001 is having the higher entropy than 1000, or all zeros are there, that is the 4 zeros are there. This is having the lowest entropy than 4 ones are there. So in general way, what comment is there out of certain research, it is said that if the entropy of the plain text you are having plus the entropy of the cryptographic key you are using, we'll consider that both are having the same size for the key and whatever the your bit patterns are there, or even if it is having some different sizes, doesn't matter. So if the entropy of the plain text plus entropy of the crypt key if you are going for, then it is judgmentally said that it should be equal to the entropy of your cipher text. So if I just keep this equation in a mind, and if I move further, it is observed that most of the times this particular equation is satisfied in such a way the key is designed that it is suitable for your plain text, that both the entropies are somewhat equivalent to the entropy of your cipher text. And if such cases are there, okay, we can say that it is going in a proper way. If the equation, that equality is not balanced, that if I say that if this is the left hand side, there is the LHS, and this is the right hand side, there is the RHS. If the entropy of LHS is less than the entropy of RHS, then it derives only one plain text. That means so far what we are doing is going under this category. That means the security with certain perfections are there, some specific security is there, some targeted security is there. From the C4, you are retrieving back the same plain text. There is no confusion at all for the retrieving back, and that will be the one and the only one. But I would like to go for the second interesting case, that if the equation reverse in the particular relation, that LHS, if it is greater than the RHS entropy, then I can say that we may derive multiple decryptions and all decryptions are equally valid. That means it is not going for one-to-one function, but it is going for the many-to-one function. I would like to say that there is an example of say pattern of your say worm is there. So there are different styles of the worms that whenever we try to capture the specific pattern of the worm movement or the expansion in a particular computer, then every time it may have some different expansion. That means if we try to decrypt this one, it is giving me all time a various movement. Then this particular thing is possible with the second case itself. So in that case, you are having certain security, and that security is with certain say you are having some confusion for this one, and you are not able to pick any valid decryption because all decryptions are the valid one. So this is actually the other part of your cryptography. Most of the cases are lying in the first situation, but nowadays some research is going on for the second case cryptography, wherever you can have certain, you may increase the complexity of the deriving of your plain text, and that's why it may have certain confusion for the opponent itself. Okay, so that actually is very interesting case. Now another example I would like to share with you. Let G is the function where K key is used, with the n bits are there and pseudo random generator is there. I should comment that last half size bits are available to you. That means if one byte is given to you, n is equal to 8. So if one nibble is known to you, so is it easy to compute the remaining half of the bits knowing the half of the bits for you? So in that case we can find it out. So if the answer is yes, I can say that the remaining half bits are predictable. If the answer is no, the remaining half is not predictable. In that way we can consider. So obviously whenever the predictability of any function is considered, say for the particular instance of the position I, which is ranging from 0 to n minus 1 for total n bits, in general I am talking about the n bits or the 8 bits or the 64 bits are there. So in that case I would like to comment that okay, these are predictable because half of the elements are known to you and you want to find out the remaining half. Actually there is a situation that you can create one table. That tabular entries will allow you, I can give you one analysis of DES algorithm in what way the matching can be carried out, and even 2 DES or 3 DES algorithm we are using, it is not increasing my complexity 2 times or the 3 times. Even though the 3 DES is there or the 2 DES is there, it is not equivalent to your multiplied by 2 DES simultaneously. So such situation is there, that is, it is predictable, and if it is predictable, definitely I can say that the pseudo random generator is not secure, it is insecure. So probability of your key is there, even though the key is picked up in a random fashion for your instance K, if the algorithm A, which is involving the function pseudo random function, which is going for the key K, and if there is a chance for guessing I plus 1 position bit out of series of 1 to I bits, even though the half of the bits are known, then the half is the probability for already known plus some delta probability is there, and that delta probability we should not say that it's a negligible. So what is the criteria for the negligible? Again, it is dependent on the size. If I say that delta may be 1 upon 1000 or it may be 1 upon 2 raised to 32, if I just go for the size of the data as the 1 GB, so it is approximately 1 upon 2 raised to 30 if the total size of the data you consider, then I can say that if my delta, which is greater than or equal to 1 upon 2 raised to 30 for the 1 GB of data, then if that much of the delta information is there, some change is there, then such delta cannot be considered as negligible. This error cannot be considered. Delta, normally it is treated as the error. So whenever error comes out in the picture, we try to discard the error. But which error is to be discarded, which error is to be considered, that is totally dependent on the size of your data. So over this size of the data, if such type of the error is there, we should not discard this, we should not eliminate this. It is non-negligible error, and that should be considered for the guessing of the probability. So this is actually one of the hint what I have given to you. So I want to use some cryptography and cryptographic security by increasing the length of the key, by defining a specific pattern of the key and making the key secure rather than making the algorithm secure, because algorithmic steps are known to everyone. So the security lies in the security of the key and the designing of the key and the key length itself, and these issues needs to be considered in a very proper way. So as usual, I have given you my email ID. So if any question, definitely you can tag me, you can ping me, so that we can have further discussions over this one. Thank you.